inflation, the police commander is here, and I'm sure he may be aware. I'm not targeting you, commander, but I'm telling it as it is. It is sad. Inflation of ages of juveniles by corrupt police officers to have them convicted in world prisons. That's why we have a lot of juveniles in prison. The reason I've enumerated on all this is that these are the reasons why our prisons have become congested.
Yo, etie for nyamia da Roma, ya babi du kita ewo Volta region. E jumedi ye dea baha ni se, e ye Amnesty International, ye human rights group, a ria si nyina omaji dinpa. Won a invite me se meme kasa as guest speaker. Na men kasa mfo bruni be kasa improving prison conditions. A dea omai gana, ye be ye, na e ye ye prisons ha, e hun sem bibri ha, emfata, a itia won wa won wo mu human rights no. Meme kasa, na we are seeing that they beat me a year after na Ghana prisons assessor. In the moment, kind of who said you might be who a war kita a war voter region. Yadamase.
Mayor of Hallandale, John Hensley, and the other prominent individuals. Therefore, this year, when Amnesty International needed someone to talk on our theme, improving prison condition in Ghana, a necessary step towards the protection of rights of prison inmates, we couldn't search far because we knew the very person who is fit to talk on this theme. So we called, and he heartily, happily accepted the clarion call. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, help me welcome Mr. Ibrahim Oppong Kwarteng.
Thank you very much. And let me say, this is a very tall eulogy coming in there. I would want to thank every one of you here. The director, Amnesty International, AGM chair, board chair, distinguished and police commander. The media is also here. We want to thank you for being here with us and all protocols observed. I deem it a great honor to be invited as the guest speaker to speak on a subject which constitutes a component in determining Ghana's human rights record, but which has unfortunately not been given the required attention by stakeholders in the criminal justice delivery chain. I would therefore want to congratulate Amnesty International Ghana on settling on the subject, improving prison conditions in Ghana, a necessary step towards the protection of rights of prison inmates. The choice of this topic by Amnesty International, I am sure, may have been influenced by their knowledge of the deplorable living conditions in Ghana's 44 prisons and the perceived abuses of the rights of prisoners. A development your outfit has from time to time urged prison authorities and successive governments to take a critical look at. So the question is, why have successive governments over the years continued to turn a deaf ear to calls for improvement in prison conditions in a country that prides itself as the champion of human rights? That's a very big question we are asking, and which we continue to ask. The answer, as you may be aware, stems from the cultural notion of prisoners as criminals who deserve no human rights, as well as society's deep-seated hatred for those behind bars. That is the cultural notion. Unfortunately, we forget that if you visit the prisons, if you interact with prisoners, you get to know that most of them, I would say most, I use the quantifier most, because how many prisoners are given access to lawyers when they, how many accused persons are given access to lawyers when they have a case? So the fact that someone goes to prison doesn't mean the person may have committed a crime. We will show you a video to that effect. So this notion appears to have also negatively influenced successive governments to look down on the prison institution, preventing them from fulfilling the constitutional obligation enshrined in our statute books on the promotion of the human rights of prisoners. This seeming laxity on the part of successive governments, and I'm not blaming one government because it has been so perhaps since independence, this laxity appears to have also affected the mandate of the Ghana Prison Service as enshrined in NRC D 46D of the 1992 Constitution, which is to ensure the promotion of the rights of prisoners, provision of spacious accommodation for inmates, and provision of proper health care and education for them, among others. The laxity of successive governments over the years in retooling the prison service has equally prevented the service from adequately meeting the international standards for handling of prisoners in accordance with UN rules and other international laws, such as the standard minimum rules for the treatment of prisoners and the UN Convention on the Prevention of Torture, among others. It is not surprising, therefore, that out of the 44 prisons, we have 44 prisons in Ghana, in the country, 39 of the 44 are still relics of the pre-independence era, some of which served as warehouses used by colonialists and merchants. Prisons such as Yendi, Gambaga, and others are apologies of institutions which, by current principles of penal administration, should serve as correctional centers. But what do we see? 62 years after independence, we still warehouse large numbers of human beings in very deplorable conditions. And I deliberately chose the word warehouse. You know how a warehouse is like. And if human beings are warehoused, then it's unfortunate. Human beings are not supposed to be warehoused. The end result is that most prisoners in Ghana continue to queue in large numbers to visit the toilets. They queue to bath and shit in containers in the full glare of their fellow inmates in congested spaces at night when they don't have access to toilets in the main prison yard, because it's against prison regulations for the prison yard, which, you know, obviously has a toilet, to be open to inmates at night. That is the prison regulation. We'll show you some videos, and so I don't want to talk much about that. The harsh design of Ghana's colonial prison cells, poor lighting and ventilation have led to persistent outbreak of communicable diseases in most of the prisons, which has led to the loss of lives of some inmates. It is a pity that while the police and military have hospitals, it appears we do not see the need. I shouldn't use we, it appears governments do not see the need, because government does not expect me and you to go and then construct that, unless maybe GCB comes to the aid of the prisons. Yeah, so it is equally surprising that in this time and age, the feeding fee, Amnesty has already spoken about it, for a prisoner in Ghana is 1 cedi 80 pesos, which is a quarter of a dollar, which means that 60 pesos in the morning, 60 pesos in the afternoon, 60 pesos in the evening. That is it. So you may have seen some prison food. If you give it to your dog, I'm not sure the dog would even eat it. That is what is being eaten by human beings, some of whom may not have even committed any crime. They did not have the service of a lawyer. They couldn't talk in court. Some of them shivered in court. Some of them don't know the difference between innocent and guilty. They are serving outrageous prison sentences. The massive overcrowding in Ghana's prisons is no news at all. We have brought out many documentaries detailing how most inmates sleep in tents. They sleep in tents. So some of them, have to wake up. The senior man, the jailman, the senior jailman has to clap his hands for those who slept first to wake up, for the others standing to take their turn. It's not a joke. That is the reality. We will show you some videos. And I'm happy that the prison service is not shying away from this. At first, we couldn't take cameras in there. Then, Sawan Medium Security Prison, built for 700 inmates after independence, and which now accommodates close to 4,000. Comes as a surprise to you. Then the Kumasi Central Prison, built for 400 inmates, now houses close to the same figure as in Sawan. The huge congestion we have all come to know has come about because of the following reasons. So I'm giving some of the reasons which have led to the huge congestion we are experiencing in our prisons. One is the absence of alternative punishments by courts for first-time offenders. There are no alternative punishments. We have the non-custodial sentencing bill. It's a bill in parliament which, when passed, will have what we call community sentence. But the bill has been in parliament for close to 6-7 years. And it appears no one cares. So if someone goes to steal a banana, we are not saying stealing is good. If two adolescents engage in some, petty crime, every single offense takes one into prison. Every single offense, because we don't have alternative punishments. Yeah, so we don't have. So another point is the excessive high prison sentences meted out to offenders in the absence of non-custodial options. You usually hear people, he's been given, a young man being given 40 years, 50 years. You have heard in the news just last week of a boy who was in prison when he was 15 years. It is against the law to imprison, a 15-year-old boy in a walled prison. It is against the law. But the law is usually flouted with impunity. I was in Kumasi last week. And the point is, when people were commenting, why? As if the lawmakers are not aware. But there are a lot of juveniles in the country's prisons. And it would explain the reason why we have a lot of juveniles there. Another point is lengthy trial processes resulting in long stay on remand. Unnecessary jailing of large numbers of addicted cannabis inmates, instead of passing the Narcotics Control Commission bill into law to decriminalize cannabis use. Culturally, if someone goes to smoke a joint of weed, it's culturally reprehensible. Our culture frowns on that. But what we forget is that most of these people need help. They have become addicted, just as us. Some people have become addicted to Guinness. It's become a hell, you know. So do we send such people to prison? Do we send those who smoke cigarettes to prison? We know the health hazards in smoking cigarettes. Someone goes to smoke a joint of weed and he's given a minimum sentence of 10 years. He didn't commit any crime. He has a problem. He needs help. It's a health and human rights issue. In Ghana, we have a law, PNDC law 236, that pushes for criminalization of drug use. So if you go, why don't we target the, you know, the large outgrowers, the kingpins, the cocaine dealers, those who export? But someone who says, if I don't take it, I'm not able to work. Mine workers, that's fine. They need help. Then you give them 10 years. Someone smokes, you give him 10 years in prison, 5 years. It doesn't make sense. So we are calling on Parliament to pass the Narcotics Control Commission Bill into law to decriminalize cannabis use. We appear not to be serious as a country. And the inflation, the police commander is here, and I'm sure he may be aware. I'm not targeting you, commander, but I'm telling it as it is. It is sad. Inflation of ages of juveniles by corrupt police officers to have them convicted in world prisons. That's why we have a lot of juveniles in prison. The reason I've enumerated on all this is that these are the reasons why our prisons have become congested. And so a juvenile commits an offense, he's 15 years, and then a corrupt police officer allegedly tells the mother, give me 200 cedis, give me 400 cedis. The mother, the poor mother as usual, is not able to give that amount of money. So the juvenile can also write his own statement. The police has to write the statement. And the police, corrupt police, by you know, officer, inflates the age of the juvenile so that he can be convicted in a world prison. These are not mere narratives. These are things happening. We see it all the time. We've done a lot of investigations on it and so on and so forth. And then at times, a police officer can say that, no, you are more than 15 years. Why don't you go for the birth certificate? There's no time to do that. It's very unfortunate. And I hope that the police administration weeds out some of these miscreants in the police service whose activities have led to the large numbers that we have in our prisons. Again, on the police, distorting of facts in the writing of statements for unlettered accused persons. How many people are able to write their statement? And I always say, is it wrong for the police to write someone's statement for them? But because we have a large unlettered population, you can also blame the police at times. They have to assist them. And so if the police has a beef with you, what do you expect the policeman to write? What do you expect him to say? And especially in a country where at times, who can't call police station, I know it is them. You know, if the policeman is not God-fearing and then takes money from the complainer, and then he is coming to write your statement for you, what do you expect him to write? These are some of the things. It's sad. Right. Missing dockets of those on remand and convicts. These missing dockets are allegedly orchestrated by corrupt police officers and court officials as punishment for convicts and remanders who allegedly refused to pay bribes in the trial process. So when your document, when your docket is missing, I'm sure you know the implication. How can you appeal your sentence? You have to be there for the rest of your life. If you have been given 50 years, you'll be there. So such inhuman and degrading treatment meted out to usually poor and unlettered inmates have largely contributed to the large prison numbers with its resultant deplorable prison conditions and abuse of the human rights of prisoners in Ghana's 44 prisons. So we have state agencies who are supposed, in the midst of all these problems I've spoken about, we have state agencies who are supposed to check the flagrant abuses of the law, breaches of the law. Do they do their work? Let's see. The Attorney General's Department, SRACH, the Department of Legal Aid, Social Welfare, the Mental Health Authority, the Ministry for the Interior, some of the agencies required under the law to conduct periodic visits to the prisons to assess the conditions there and report to government for the necessary action to be taken. Unfortunately, it appears these agencies have not been able to live up to their responsibilities. So how then can we have improved prison conditions when the agencies required by law to conduct periodic visits appear to be asleep? How do we have improve prison conditions. At least if they go in periodically, they can make a lot of recommendations to government for improved prison conditions. But it's unfortunate. The media, let's come to the media. The media is required to mirror society by reporting on such infractions. But it also appears that extending the media's accountability function into prisons has been largely difficult. The fourth estate is usually prevented from doing so because of the excuse, and the emphasis is on the excuse, because of the excuse usually used by governments and prison authorities that prisons are security institutions and so should be immune from media, you know, scrutiny. No, you know, it's a secret institution. With the camera there, then you don't have to know. It's a secret institution. And so that has been the excuse. But such an excuse is a very porous one because it defeats the principal objective of security sector reform, which is to ensure that security establishments are democratically and accountably managed. So I've made some recommendations here. To ensure an improvement in prison conditions, I would urge government to strengthen prison oversight by following the UK model, where prison oversight functions are performed by statutory institutions that have exclusive legal authority to report on conditions in public and private prisons and other detention facilities. We don't have private prisons here, though. I would also urge government to appoint a chief inspector of prisons. We have a chief inspector of prisons in the UK. We have a chief inspector of prisons in the US. And so this chief inspector of, in the UK for instance, usually see the justice minister in some discomfort. Usually see the justice minister shivering when the chief inspector of prisons is about to release his quarterly reports. The reports are usually damning reports. Why can't we have an independent institution like a chief inspector of prisons who would do the, you know, periodic visits, conduct the periodic visits, so that maybe every 3 months Amnesty knows that there's going to be a report by a chief inspector of prisons. It will push government to work. My plea goes to Amnesty International. All the bosses are here. My plea goes to you to add a naming and shaming component to your report on the prisons to awaken agencies and individuals that have shirked their responsibilities of ensuring improved prison conditions. I also call on government to privatize some of the prisons. The UK has 14 private prisons. If you are giving them 180%, it's obvious we cannot adequately fund public prisons in this country. So why shouldn't government possibly privatize some of the prisons to ensure effective operations and to reduce the huge cost associated with the running of the country's 44 public prisons? I implore Parliament to hasten the passage of the non-custodial sentencing bill into law. With the law on community service, petty offenders could contribute to society by deserting choke gutters, cleaning the streets. Our streets are, our country is smelling, planting for food and jobs among others, instead of throwing them into prison and feeding them with the taxpayers' money. It doesn't make sense. I'd also appeal to the President to grant amnesty to prisoners. Since our dear President came, he's here to grant amnesty. And it's very, very unfortunate. Though the granting of amnesty is his prerogative, it is the President's prerogative. You cannot take him to court. We hope he appreciates the suffering of first-time offenders who need a second chance in life. The aged, some of them are so weak, they cannot walk. Some of them are dying. Amnesty has visited the prisons. I'm sure you've seen it all. The aged and the terminally ill who do not constitute any threat to society. If you release such a person, the person is dying. He's in prison, adding up to the numbers. There is no space. We are going to watch how they are arranged when they sleep. Now my final appeal goes to the police administration. I have attacked the police today, but they should take it in good faith because it is sad. It could be their children. It could be anybody. My final appeal goes to the police administration to put in place an audio-visual recording system that will enable unlettered accused persons to record their statements. It could be made available to the judge instead of leaving them in the hands of the police to write sometimes distorted statements for poor, usually poor accused persons. I want to thank you very much.
Ibrahim Oppong Kwarteng. So on behalf of the bank, we'd like to present this to you. We're looking for your work.